Welcome, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. When John Morrison asked me to come here, I said, Dublin, Ireland, of course. Remember last time I was here, I did the famous distillery tour. It was a great tour. I should not report, we can talk about that in the evening. But then John also said, you would need to talk in the heterogeneous computing session. And I said, what should I talk there? I mean, do I really have something? So what I did is, I tried to formulate kind of an idea, which I want to present to you, which gives you some new items about what we are doing at the Leibniz Supercomputing Center. And I'm happy to hear your opinions afterwards. So that's what I put together. Let me start with the Leibniz Supercomputing Center, which is these five buildings in front. So we have, of course, lots of office space. We have a lecture room building. We have a visualization center. And the big stuff is here with all the machines. Five floors, 10,000 square meters. That's where we have the machines. So important is, of course, we are doing that with approximately 250 employees, including all the students that are working, including the 24-hour shift. We have about 100,000 students who are being served by our services, and we have about 30,000 employees, including about 8,500 scientists. And we are only providing support for science. We don't do any SAP, we don't do any financial stuff, we do only the fun stuff. Whatever the scientists need to do their work. And we do this for a number of different entities. Most important is the entities, the Munich universities. So there are a number of universities around, and we are their computing center. So basically, instead of each university have its own computing center, we are the computer center for all the Munich universities. We are also one of the state computing centers providing on the larger scale those things that you need in all of Bavaria. And then, of course, we are also a member of the Gauss Center for Supercomputing. I'll come back to that in a second, which is the German National Supercomputing Center, which comprises the three biggest centers with the three biggest machines. We have extra funding for the top-level machine. And some part of the top-level machine goes to the European Supercomputing Center, meaning that scientists from Europe also can apply for cycles. In that case, that goes through PRACE, and if you do your research, you qualify for that, you can access the machines. And one of the machines is here on the top floor. That is SuperMOOC. Actually, it's two machines. On the back, you see SuperMOOC Phase 1, which was installed in 2012, which has a peak performance of about 3.2 petaflops. And in 2015, we got these two rows of racks, which is SuperMOOC Phase 2, which had also 3.2, 3.6 petaflops peak performance, which by itself is already an interesting observation. These two small racks, 3 years later, are the same as this one. And the entire room has about 1,200 square meters, so you really see the progress. So we have some space empty here, there's more machines here now already, and the space empty here will be used for a smaller machine, which should replace everything here. And that's how the growth works, so we have to cycle, one machine comes in, next one goes out, this way. The important thing is, of course, all these machines are useless if you don't do any science with it. The good thing is at LSE we have a huge list. So we are somewhere between, depending on how you count, 200 different, 600 to 600 different applications, 600 different groups which are using their machines. Not all of them are on SuperMOOC, but the big ones are on SuperMOOC, and you see it goes through everything you can see. We're also doing some parts, for instance, there's climate research. If the German Climate Research Center has to offload some stuff, we're doing that. The biggest stuff in our center is computational fluid dynamics, which has everything to do with, of course, there's lots of cars industry, there's some air industry, these kinds of things. Second part is astrophysics, solid state physics, geophysics. We know that astrophysics can take up any cycles you have. It doesn't matter, whatever you give them, they will find some use for it. And then, of course, there are all these other areas. Now, that's a good thing. And the good thing with SuperMOOC is it's a general purpose machine. So it has CM processors, and basically the idea was We support the scientist from his work table up to the highest computing power. So you can, in principle, use the same code on one machine on the Earth. And that was my question. That's not heterogeneity. It's homogeneous from your table to the big machine. And of course, if you see, even having a homogeneous machine, SuperMOOC was the fastest, in that sense, the fastest general purpose machine when it was bought. So we were place 4 on the top 500 list, which is a good achievement. I'll come back to the top 500 list today, and you will see it looks much different if you look at general purpose. And that was the idea of my talk. So at that point in time, we were there with the Xeon processor and 147,000 cores, and that's where we have this 3.2 petaflops peak performance. You also see the power consumption. You see that here with the blue chain, for instance, you have many more cores, but only little more power consumption. And that is one of the differences. And of course, you have also difference with different architectures, programming models, and these kinds of things. Anyway, SuperMOOC was also only the last in the series, so we always had different machines. And SuperMOOC is somewhere here. You also see that this is the exponential increase in both flops and memory. So memory is the yellow one, the computing power is the red one, and we were always trying to be along this curve, kind of, because the scientists required. The funny thing is, when SuperMOOC came in, basically 3 months later, it was full again. And now you have again a waiting time for your jobs from 3 days, 4 days, something like that. So there is some demand there, and that's why we are following this curve kind of. You also see that we have all different machines, yeah? Here, Hitachi, Fujitsu, vector processor. So we're also following kind of what the architecture gives you and try to find the best solution for the users. And as I said, the last idea was you have everything from the desktop up to the biggest machine. SuperMOOC Phase 2 is the same following. And here you already see a difference. I'll again have that on a slide later. Xeon is not the same as Xeon. So we're starting to introduce the heterogeneity there, but very slowly. The first distinction between the last, these are the last four machines basically we had. The biggest distinction that you see is not only the performance that you get. So there's quite a huge performance increase factor of 50 between two of the machines, but you also see the number of cores. So one of the questions, of course, can you make use of these cores for your applications? And to tell the truth, before we bought this machine, our staff members were very critical and said, will we ever be able to use 150,000 cores? Actually, we can also see how many cores the applications are using. And you see there is a share, most of the 21% are using 512,024 cores. So it's not all applications that use the full machine, but it's rather a very diverse area. So they always use how many cores they need. There are a few of them who go up to the biggest core. Actually, if we take a look at the top 500 list, so here you have some of the statistics, and we go back to the year 1996, we can basically draw, this is the 500 positions, and here is the number of cores. So in 1996, most of the systems had around 100 cores. 10 years later, we see they had around 1,000 cores. And again, 10 years later, we are at 100,000 cores. And that also means that the users have to come up. You need to make your code run with more cores. You need to think of that. And everybody knows, of course, Amdahl's law, these kinds of things, so we need bigger workloads, we need corresponding codes, and these kinds of things to do. So there's some introduction here, but we were able to do that. That's one application. That application runs in production mode on all the cores of SuperMOOC. So it uses everything that is there for one application. The production run runs somewhere between 5 and 7 hours. And it is quite good in terms of the performance. So we get from the 3.2 petaflops, we come up to almost 44% of the peak performance for production run. And that is repeated for other applications. So at this point in time, we are close to 20 applications which use the entire system. So it was worth buying this because they could not do this before. So this is a seismic analysis job, and they are simulating basically the earthquake under this volcano, and they could only do this with that resolution by using the entire system. And of course there's also something else hidden in between here. The power consumption, that program run, just the power consumption, is somewhere between 5 and 7,000 euros per program run. That's just what you put in as power here. Of course you have to take more into consideration. If you go to the back of the machine, to the architecture of the machine, you see there is 18 SYN nodes with 8,000 cores each. So there's a huge kind of portion of cores which are homogeneous. But the architecture is far from being homogeneous. We have one FET node island with around 8,200 cores, which has more memory per core. And again, you're introducing heterogeneity on a very soft level. You have to consider, is your code good for this island or is it good for this island? Or do you need a mixture of both islands for running that? You also need to consider other things like background memory. Where is my data that I want to process? And that gets all into consideration. In fact, if we put the two systems together side by side, we see there is the performance which is identical, but the number of cores is of course different. The cores themselves are different, and the memory per core is different. So even using this machine and this machine, while they have the same performance, give you different performance on your application. And even if we say it's both Xeon, it gives you something else depending on which system that you are running on, which is kind of contradicting what I said before. Actually, the German approach is even different because we say we are choosing, depending on the application, which system you are getting your cycles on. So if you apply to the German Gauss Center for Supercomputing, which I mentioned before, the National Center for Supercomputing, you apply with your code, you must prove that you're doing excellent research, and you must prove that your code fits to one of the three machines. And then you will be actually going to the most appropriate machine. So you have the heterogeneity even on the national level. And that's a strategic approach. That's why the Germans say we need three machines, because with that we believe we can best serve the scientific community by giving them three different characteristics. Now let's go back to the power consumption. That is an issue. But what does it have to do with heterogeneity? I'll show you. So we had the power increase over the last years. You see the years low. You see that basically we are going up with the consumption over the years. We also see there's one between 2009 and 2010, there was no increase, which means we didn't buy any machines. Of course not. We're buying a new cluster every year, more or less. The interesting thing here is we didn't have any increase because we moved from air cooling to water cooling. So the power, was the performance was increased, but we were using different cooling. And these are the years where SuperMOOC came in. And SuperMOOC is using even more advanced energy efficient cooling. Yeah. But what does that have to do? Well, first of all, when you buy the machine, you have to kind of prepare your room and you have a huge infrastructure. So the infrastructure effort that we are putting in is big. That means these are the water connectors. So each of the cabinets has a water connector. There is a huge kind of management system in the back, and you have three cycles which are kind of dealing with making sure that the water goes through the system. There's 8 million liters of water in the system at any point in time. You also see that it requires much more in terms of putting the whole picture together, because we're using this direct liquid cooling, warm water cooling, we're using energy-aware scheduling and all these things. And in the end, we actually get some saving. Using this, we save 2 million euros just in operational costs. We still spend this 2 million, but we can spend it on other things, not on just cooling the system. And that has to do, again, with the users. What does it have to do? Why is the user concerned about running energy efficient? The user wants to run the job, or why should they? Well, the truth is, with these savings, we can give the users more. So if you run your cove energy efficient, we can give you more cycles. And you can run more of your simulations. You can run probably bigger simulations. So that's the goal. The other point is, of course, your codes may run differently between two runs, depending on the outside temperature, depending on what the other applications are doing on the system. So you have heterogeneity even between runs, because the same code may act differently, because we want in the overall system to make sure that we're running efficient. So that puts everything together. And then the question is, if you have all that, running energy efficient, could you, for instance, use both of the systems concurrently? Could you use all the computing power we have for one particular application? And again, I'm simplifying here. This is only one floor. We have some more floors with other machines, many more cores around. But just for SuperMOOC, we had one application which were using both of the things. So they took the application for 37 hours. And as I said, on average, 1 hour is about 1,000 euro just in electricity bill. So they were using 37 hours for one particular application, which simulates docking of potential drugs for breast cancer. That's an application done by Peter Coveney inside a couple of projects, MEPA Compat and Biomed. They put this together. They were using 8 million CPU hours. And actually, we didn't know if that is a success. So we gave them the machine Friday lunchtime, and we put back into user operation Monday morning. And then we had some excited scientists, you know, they were happy that they were in. They really found some use. That's why we are doing it. Now, this is not the typical HPC application. This uses combination of HPC, HTC, and all these things together. This is a very heterogeneous application. And only with these software techniques developed here, they were able to really use the system. And that's not the worst case of what we want to do. We want to do much more in terms of workflows, you know, where you basically, you compute part of your chip on your GPU cluster, then you move over to the general purpose cluster, then you move to the next accelerated cluster. So there is some more things to come. What's next? The view into the future. Actually, if you take a look today, so that's the last two machines, HLFB2, top 500, 6 June 2006, we had that teraflops, we had that increase, that's the factor of 50 that I mentioned before. So that's the last two machines. And if you see, it was 2007, 2012, so basically we should be getting to the new machine now. That's what we are doing. We are involved in coming up with the next machine, which is called SuperMOOC Next Generation. And there is all these procurement going on. And of course, for legal reasons, I'm not allowed to tell any of the secrets. But what I want to do with you is I want to take a look into what would you buy if you have the machine? So we secured the funding, which is about 100, it's 460 divided by 3 because the 3 centers get it. So it's about 160 million that we have to spend on this machine. And actually, what you do is you would take a look at the top 500 list. And I don't understand why the graphics is not good enough. But if you take a look at the machines in the range where you are investing, you see that many of them using different applications. There is no pure Xeon machine up there. All of them have some kind of special processor, or they have accelerators. That's Xeon Phi in there. Actually, what we see is, if you take a look at the performance projection, we see that the curve is going down slightly. So we don't have the same increase in performance as we used to have before. And apparently, systems are using accelerators and thereby becoming more heterogeneous in order to kind of keep up the curve. You have the same performance, the power envelope. You need to get in more performance. You need to do something special. And actually, if we take a look at the accelerators, we see that there's from the 500 lists on top 500, there is enough which really rely heavily on accelerators. And you have GPUs, you have many cores, you have many different approaches. So we need to think about how, again, if we want to spend the money for the scientists, what can we do to make sure that they get the best performance out of the system? So if you come back to that slide and say, SuperMOOC NG, what are we doing? We have, of course, the topmost selection criteria is always the application mix. And we know that each application behaves differently. They have different requirements in terms of cores, different requirements in terms of memory usage, different requirements in terms of the interconnect. So we basically take all these 200 to 600 applications and try to make a picture that is reasonable for us, which by itself is a funny task. Of course, you have to take some choices here. Then you have to think about how many accelerators do you put in? Not only what accelerators and how many of them? How much of your budget do you spend on GPUs, on accelerators? Which kind of them are you using? And what effect does it mean on the user? So there is again heterogeneity here. Of course, you would probably think about why don't we use Docker or other kinds of virtualization in there, yeah? That has also to do with that. And does that mean you need x86 again, Xeon processors for running that? Or do you have virtualization? Could you run Xeon cores on other? Of course, lots of fun. I mentioned the workflow engines. I mentioned the high throughput computing, which is not our task for these machines. We have other machines for high throughput computing. But assuming that, again, you want to run a very big stuff, you could not run this on the other smaller high throughput computing. And, of course, there's the power consumption, which, again, if we improve on that, all the other things will benefit. If we use less power, the user will benefit. So we have this heterogeneous system. And actually, I believe what we need to do is to put more users, more brains on it, because otherwise it doesn't work. We call this the Partnership Initiative Computational Sciences. We want to work with the users to make sure they understand this heterogeneous environment. They come with their codes and we help them to make the best out of that. So what we're doing is we provide individualized services for selected groups. You cannot do this for everybody, unfortunately, because budget is limited as usual. But what we want to do is we have some flagship projects. And if we can kind of help them to get there, they could be a role model for the others. And I'll show you one of these areas later on this slide. So we have this individual support, guidance, these kinds of things. We also want to make sure that they understand that computer scientists are not just service providers. With this environment we have, you need to have partners. You need to work on equal footing. Yeah? You don't want your application users to understand all the complex, what you would like, that they understand all the complexities of your system. But they are interested naturally in their applications. That's what they should do. So we need to go there, we need to make sure that we help them use the systems efficiently, and that means doing joint research projects, making sure that you are embedded in the system. And of course, for us, the real background is we also understand more of the requirements of our users. We're trying to develop the future services, so if you buy the next machine. And we found some thematic focusing, that's environmental computing. We thought actually the three national centers decided on focus areas for each of them, and ours was environmental computing. There is some social aspect, so society benefits from that. There's also lots of needs there for high performance computing for many of these things that I mentioned, so this is a good thing. And actually what we did is we put this together and wrote down an article. I think you can get the, at least I gave away my slides, so if not, just send me an email, I'll be happy to give you a link to them. So we put this together in a paper demonstrating how useful that is, and I think if you want to attract heterogeneity, you need to put more brain power even in them today. And there's also one thing which I don't want to go into too much detail, that's our cookbook in a sense. This is kind of the steps that we are doing, which kind of start, first of all, choose the area that you want to focus on, then talk to the user community, set up some workshops. We're also doing joint lectures, for instance, which is an interesting, I mean, if I as a computer scientist go to a lecture which is 50% done by hybrid metrologists, which I can still learn lots of things, of course. And then you have these links. We are actually embedding people. We have some of the center people spending one day a week or some other time with the communities, having a table there, discussing what are your needs, what can we do to make sure that you're running. And all of that forced by the heterogeneity of the system, of the infrastructure, of the workplace, of what the scientists need to do their work on. And with that, I hope I was able to make a little bit out of the case for the heterogeneous computing, give you some of the picture that we are doing, and I'm happy to take questions if there are any. Thank you. Thank you.